In the last video, we talked about big babies, and I touched on the issue of shoulder dystocia. This video will be a deep dive into the topic so that you can understand it better. Shoulder dystocia occurs when the baby's head is born but the shoulders are stuck, making it very difficult for the baby to be born, and it's a form of obstetric emergency. There are factors which will increase the risk of this occurring, namely a big baby, a woman with diabetes, a woman with a BMI greater than 30, prolonged labour, induction, if the labour was augmented with oxytocin, if birth required assistance with either ventouse or forceps, as well as women who've had previous shoulder dystocia, which can increase the risk by tenfold. In the UK, there was a Supreme Court case involving a mother with diabetes known to be carrying a big baby. Unfortunately, she experienced a shoulder dystocia, leading to the child having significant disabilities. This led to what is known as the Montgomery ruling, which had a significant impact with how we advise and manage women with big babies. It highlighted the importance of providing women with informed choices, which I believe is hugely important in healthcare. The overall risk of a shoulder dystocia is low, but bigger babies are likelier to encounter this problem. And not all big babies are created equally. If the pregnancy is complicated by diabetes, especially ones which are diagnosed before the pregnancy, the chance of a shoulder dystocia is higher. And that's because the weight is distributed differently on babies of diabetic parents. Although some of this data is slightly old, this chart shows that the risk is lowest for non-diabetic mothers whose baby weigh less than 4,000 grams, which is 8 pounds 13 ounces, and the risk increases and is at its highest if the baby weighs more than 4,500 grams, which is 9 pounds 15 ounces. But if mum has type 1 or type 2 diabetes, the risk is greater regardless of baby's weight, and is at its highest if the baby weighs over 4,500 grams, which is why we would recommend a cesarean birth. Reassuringly, when a shoulder dystocia is suspected, most babies will be born quickly, with simple interventions. However, complications can still arise, affecting both mum and child. For mums, there's a greater chance of severe vaginal or perineal tears involving the muscles of the back passage. This can also cause significant blood loss, which we call postpartum hemorrhage. It can also have a psychological effect on both mums and their birth partners, especially when staff members are rushing into the room when the emergency alarm is sounded. All units provide parents with space and time to reflect on their birth experience. So if you feel that your birth has led to you experiencing trauma, it's important that you speak to one of us or someone else whom you trust. For babies, a complication that can occur is the fracture of the humerus, which is a long bone from the shoulder to the elbow. Oftentimes, these injuries heal quickly without any lasting damage. The main complication we worry about is nerve damage. We all have nerves running along the side of our necks, which we call the brachial plexus. They supply our fingers, our hands, and our wrists. Therefore, damage to the brachial plexus will risk us losing function to these structures. It's important to know that brachial plexus injuries can also occur without a shoulder dystocia, and around 90% of these injuries will recover within 12 months of birth. The rate of these injuries are also higher for bigger babies or those born to mothers with diabetes. Rarely would a baby suffer severe brain damage due to the lack of oxygen. Even rarer, a stillbirth may occur. As mentioned earlier, shoulder dystocia is an emergency that happens infrequently. Therefore, all midwives and obstetricians are trained regularly so that if it does occur, we will respond quickly. For most cases of shoulder dystocia, a simple intervention called McRoberts manoeuvre will help birth baby's shoulders. It helps by widening the size of the birth canal by repositioning mum. We have mum lie flat on her back with bent hips so that the knees are as close to the chest as possible. And we may also apply a bit of pressure at the front of the pelvis to move baby's shoulder away from the pubic bone. If that isn't successful, we may consider a cut, called an episiotomy, to allow more space for baby to move out. We may also try to rotate baby's shoulders so that the one that is stuck is freed. Typically, the shoulder that is stuck is the one at the front, so we may deliver the other shoulder so there's more space for baby to wiggle out into the world. Rarely would these steps fail, in which case we may have to perform critical maneuvers in the operating theatre to deliver the child. When we have to rotate the baby or deliver one of the shoulders, these steps can increase the risk of a brachial nerve injury. Therefore, after birth, they are reviewed by a pediatrician to assess whether a potential harm may have arisen from the birthing process. I know what we've discussed sounds scary, and I hope it will never happen to you. However, if it does occur, know that the team looking after you is poised to take swift actions to manage it. Give this video a like if you found this useful. Share, subscribe, and I'll see you again soon.